How you doing, everybody? This again is Attorney Anthony Reeves, and I'm giving you another wonderful legal beat tip of the day. I had a question posed to me, or more of a comment, about drugs and alcohol. I think I talked about it a little bit, but here's the question of the day. Question of the day is, how is it that somebody who may be still using drugs is getting disability benefits? Let me tell you, I know I've seen this a million times. You know somebody who's on the corner, who is still smoking that dro, still hitting that pipe, and in your mind you're thinking, how is this person getting disability benefits? Let's go through a couple of things first. First of all, let's talk about it from a historical perspective. From one point in time, there was a point in time, Social Security awarded disability benefits based on drugs and alcohol. It was presumed that they treated it as an illness, and actually there is a listing under the regulations for being addicted, of course, to drug abuse, drugs and alcohol. Now, what they did in their brilliance is they realized that it probably would be counterproductive to the whole notion of disability to award disability benefits to somebody who's using drugs or who's consuming large amounts of alcohol. Because ultimately, two things, they're causing their own self-destruction and you're ultimately financially feeding their habit. So what Social Security did is they switched to what we call the DANA materiality standard. When Social Security determines, and this is how it typically works, first, they go through the entire five-step process, meaning they look to see, are you working? Okay, if you're not working, they want to see, is it because of a health condition that lasts 12 months or more? If that's the case, they go to step three, which is, do you have a condition that they can approve you based on whether it meets the specific medical requirements of any of the listed medical conditions? Then from there they go to step four. Step four is if you don't meet those requirements, does your condition keep you from doing any of the work that you've done in the last 15 years? And then if that's the case, if they determine that you can't do your past work, they then go to make a determination of whether or not they believe you can do anything else. Now, that's the five-step sequential evaluation. So they do the five steps first. So let's assume that they go through those five steps and determine you're disabled based on that. Then, if drugs and or alcohol is present in your file in any significant amount, and most judges err to being conservative. They see there's a problem with drug alcohol abuse or alcohol use or drug abuse or anything like that. They then go to the next step of saying, sorry, bad English, is drugs and alcohol material to your disability determination? Let me tell you what that means, that materiality standard. That means we found you disabled, but if you're using drugs or if you're consuming alcohol, if we take those things away, are you still disabled? If by some reason it's determined that when you take the drugs and alcohol away, your condition improves to the point where you can go back to work, then under the regulations, they determine that those things are material to a finding of disability. In other words, you're not disabled. That means as long as you stay off the drugs and stay off the alcohol, you're not disabled. How do they look for that? Well, typically what they do is they look through your medical records and they look for the longest period of sobriety. This is one of the things that I always tell my clients whenever I have somebody who has problems with drug use or alcohol use. And usually when they come to me, the first thing I tell them, use drugs, yes, stop. Because they're going to be looking for the longest period of sobriety, and that is going to be the period that's going to be a clear or at least a strong indicator of whether you're disabled. Let's take it like this. Let's say that you had a devastating injury that's resulted in you having a fusion of your neck, fusion in your lower back, and you're on heavyweight pain medication and you've been on drugs. Well, let's say you took drugs heavily before the accident, but then after the accident, you've remained clean for like a year or so. But then the pain gets so bad, you start taking drugs again. Well, then the judge looks at a period and he notices that after the accident, you had a year where you weren't using any illegal drugs or drinking alcohol, but then you started up a year later. The judge, he or she is probably going to look at that period of time when you were sober, when you weren't using drugs or alcohol, to determine whether or not he believes those things were material to your case. So if you were really off the chain during that time period in terms of disabled, it's not unreasonable for the court to make a determination that drugs and alcohol may not have contribute does not contribute to your disability. Now, here's the areas where it gets a little weird. When there's not a period of sobriety, meaning the person uses drugs and alcohol so often that it's hard for the court to determine whether or not drugs or alcohol is material to their case. Meaning, you can't. They have to try to figure out from either a period of sobriety or looking at the medical evidence if whether or not your condition would improve. Well, how can they figure it out? Easy. Sometimes doctors will say in there, you know, I encourage the person to abstain. This is the other way they kind of slip you, catch you. One of the things that the regulations talks about is your duty to basically follow your medical protocol. In other words, the judges rely on medical records to determine whether or not they believe you are disabled. So one of the things they look at is, are you doing what your doctor tells you to do? So if your doctor tells you, stop doing drugs, stop drinking, but you're still doing it, they can kind of deny you based on not only DANA, but, you know, failure to follow medical advice. Then what happens then is that then we have the other part. So let's say we've got it where they've determined that your medical condition is not affected by the drugs or alcohol. Because really one of two things will happen. Either one, they'll say, you know what, if you stop using drugs or alcohol, then you should get better, you're not disabled. Or they'll say, because there are some conditions out there that even if you're on drugs or alcohol, it's not going to be much of an impact. Or they look at the period of sobriety. Ultimately, what they're going to do is that if they determine that their drugs or alcohol doesn't have an impact, then you go to the step where they say, okay, we're going to find you disabled. But don't be surprised if they try to assign what we call a representative payee. And for those of you, this may be a confusing video, so if you want me to kind of break down each one of these particular things that I've discussed, make sure you send me a comment and say, hey, Tony Reeves, you talked about this. Could you go and give us another video in more detail? I'd be more than happy to do so. But let's talk about representative payee, what happens here. And I've seen this happen a lot, and I usually caution clients when you have issues with drugs or alcohol. And I usually don't say this a lot, but I bring it to their attention. There may be a possibility that courts may issue you a representative payee. Meaning, not issue, they may recommend that Social Security require that you have a representative payee to handle your money. Why? Because they don't want you to go out and use that money and spend it on drugs and alcohol. It gets kind of weird back and forth, because if you're a person, you haven't used drugs like 5 or 6 years, you're probably going to be offended by the fact that Social Security even recommended it. But it's important for you to know that this is a possibility. Ultimately, what I need you to understand is this, for those of you out there who are freaking out because you can't seem to understand why somebody who's on drugs or alcohol are receiving disability benefits, keep in mind, a lot of things came into play, and even though they're getting disability benefits, they may be getting it not in the way you think. Meaning somebody else may be handling their money to make sure that they don't use it on drugs or alcohol. The drug and alcohol standard is very funky, but let me give you one final point. And of course, if you have any questions, you can always email me at anthony@reevesfirm.com, or you can definitely go to www.reevesfirm.com, or you can go to my blog, legalbeat.anthonyreeves.com. But let me make one point abundantly clear. If you're applying for disability benefits and you know that you've had a history of drugs or alcohol, or if you're currently using any type of alcohol or illegal drugs, and people, I've used drugs throughout this whole presentation, but I've been talking about illegal drugs. Stop, okay? If you know you've been drinking a lot, stop drinking. If you're using illegal drugs, get away from that hydro, crack, whatever it is, stop. And if you got any more questions, I'd be more than happy to help you out. Again, this is Anthony Reeves, and this has been your Legal Beat Tip, and I hope it helps you out. Have a great day.